Welcome, everybody. Thanks for coming. I'm here to introduce Andrew Critch, who is our speaker today. Andrew earned his PhD in mathematics at UC Berkeley, studying the applications of algebraic geometry to machine learning models. He also co-founded the Center for Applied Rationality, which is down the hall. He was at Jane Street Capital as an algorithmic stock trader before joining MIRI in September of last year, which is somewhat relevant to today's topic of conversation, which is logical induction. And I will let Critch take it from here.
Cool. This is fine. Where's the boundary is over here somewhere? Right here?
I'm in now?
Cool. All right. So thanks again, everybody, for coming. This talk's based on joint work with Scott Garibrandt, Svi Benson-Tilson, and Nate, whom you just met, and Jessica Taylor. And actually, maybe could you guys all just turn around and indicate. So Jessica, stand up. There's Nate. There's Svi right here. And Scott's there with his hand in the back. Scott's our first author. This is like his brainchild, and we've all been working hard on understanding how it works ever since he got this thing rolling. So they'll be around. You can hang out with them, ask them questions after the talk if you want. We'll all be here. And very roughly, what I'm going to do is spend 10-ish minutes saying what even is the problem that we're solving. Because it's a little bit subtle, the different notions of probability, which ones are already defined, which ones aren't. Then I'll get into the technical results, and hopefully there will be lots of questions in the middle of that so I can, like, tune. And then at the end, something of like 20-ish minutes, maybe not that long, of sort of what we think, you know, these results are for. So without further delay, I'm just going to give you guys a few examples of different kinds of uncertainty, some of which are logical uncertainty, some of which aren't, and some of which are a mixture. So consider a die roll, a roll of a 10-sided die, a D10. If I ask you, what is the probability that that die roll lands a 7, what will you say? You'll say 10%. And if I let you think longer about it, what will you say? You'll say 1/10. Right. So no matter how long, if I let you think about this thing forever, you'll still think 10%. Does that make sense? Okay. Now let's skip to the bottom of this table here. A different question. What if I asked you, what's the probability that the 10th digit of the square root of 10 after the decimal place is 7? What's the probability? What would you, if you had to make bets right now, if someone was like offering you odds on a bet,
0%. What?
Do you know? Do you know what it is?
I know for sure.
Oh, it's a trick. You want to bet? You want to bet me? So at some point, right? So early on, you're going to use 10% for your betting odds, right? But if you think about it long enough, like long enough to run a calculator in your head, long enough to multiply together some 10-digit numbers, you will say it's probably not 7 unless I screwed up. And then if you think even longer, you'll say, yeah, it's not 7. So this is a case where your probability changes, even though you haven't done any experiments, you haven't gathered any new sensory data, your sensors have not received any new inputs, you just, like, thought. And if you can't do it in your head, maybe I'll just, like, confine you to a room and call, you know, your sensors the boundary of the room. And now let's think about something in between those two. Actually, I probably should ask first, like, is it clear how these are sort of qualitatively different? This is one where you think and it changes without new sensory data. This one, you need new sensory data to change your mind. And in reality, what you often experience is a mixture of these kinds of uncertainty. So let's suppose that you actually saw the die. You, like, your eyes or a camera took a snapshot of the die just as it was rolling under a cup or something. And the snapshot looked like this. And I say, what probability do you give to 7? And you don't have much time to think about it or even visualize the die. And you start off and you're like 10%, or your machine learning algorithm starts off with a prior of 10%, because that's reasonable. But now it starts to do some computations. Okay, so either you in your head start visualizing like, okay, how could it roll? Where there was like there was a bump under the cup over there. So maybe that if that bump is big enough, it's, you know, if you think real hard, you might figure out that, you know, 7 is like a little bit more likely to come up because of like the conditions of the die. But you're still not sure because maybe you don't exactly know the mass of the interior of the dice, or you don't know exactly the shape of the table, right? You had a blurry image. But nonetheless, with some analysis and some simulations, you in your mind or your machine learning algorithm on a computer figures out after a very long time that 7 is like a bit more likely, but somehow is not able to push its probability to 0 or 1 because there's still some missing sensory data that you would need, like lifting up the cup that would answer the question for you. Does that make sense? So here I say we have a mixture of kinds of uncertainty, because the uncertainty that's left here at the end is what I would call empirical uncertainty. You need to see something new in order to change your mind. Whereas the uncertainty that makes this 10 differ from this 16 is logical uncertainty. You need to merely compute the consequences of the data you already have in order to move from here to here. So now, depending on what your favorite way of computing probabilities from data is, you might do a different computation. If you're Bayesian, you might like write down a formula using your prior and your data, and that formula tells you what your posterior should be, but you have to do a lot of computation to know that posterior. Who's familiar with the like curse of dimensionality in machine learning, where you have to, right? So you guys know what I'm talking about. Computing the actual Bayesian update is computationally intractable, but you can write it down and you can ask the question, what would this evaluate to? And that's a question of logical uncertainty. It's a math question. It's just a math question now. And if you could answer it, you could have this 16 right away. But you can't, so you have to start with this 10. Cool. So normal uncertainty is a mixture of this kind of empirical uncertainty and this logical uncertainty. And it's real important to like see that difference. If it's still not clear, we can talk more about it after the talk. But I really wanted to like elaborate on that, because otherwise things are going to seem really blurry, like the mixture between empirical and logical. So another way of carving this up is saying that the laws of probability theory, if you go on Wikipedia and you look up probability theory, you'll see some axioms that probabilities are supposed to obey. And those are axioms that are meant to be axioms that your beliefs satisfy after you've finished computing what they are. And that's assumption is sometimes called logical omniscience. It's just kind of like if you already knew the logical consequences of everything. So that's not what this talk is about. This talk is about the horizontal movements in this table. It's about what rules should these probabilities follow over time. Not the relationships between these, but the relationships between these. And also the relationship of this entire table. But this is like the neglected dimension of that table. And also, where should you even start? Like, there's an intuitive sense in which 10% is a reasonable start here, but why not 50, right? The thing's either true or false. Why not give it a probability of 50%? Right? Why don't you do that? Maybe because you notice that it's part of some family of other possibilities that don't seem that different, right? But you need some heuristic that says, all right, these are all equally likely, so let's call them all 10%, or you need to notice that it's part of a family of mutually exclusive outcomes that should all add up to 1. There are these things you need to notice. So we'd like to have some definition of doing a good job of this logical, we're calling this process logical induction, this like figuring out your probabilities over time. And we want a definition of what it means to do logical induction well, such that you could say this is 10% is doing a good job, but saying 50% is like doing a bad job. Cool? Any questions about that? Sweet. All right, so that's what we're trying to do. We're going to call the purple stuff logical induction and figure out how it should normatively work. So people have thought a lot about this in the past. I'm not going to get into all this. This is just like a visual demonstration of like a bunch of properties that people have written down that they wish limited reasoners would satisfy. They should trust themselves. They should know if they're doing a good job. They should know they're doing a good job. They should be calibrated. They should know what their own beliefs are. They shouldn't assign high probability to stuff that's not proven, et cetera, et cetera. So there's lots of properties. I'm not going to spend a lot of time dwelling on those. But we'd like to pin down some simpler compression of like all the properties that people want. And you might ask, why do we want that answer? Why do we even want an answer to this question? And my motivation, and I think a lot of our motivations on this, are that we want to write down, this is the Machine Intelligence Research Institute, right? So we're interested in writing down theories of how AI, very advanced AI, is going to work so that we can like come up with interesting, good strategies for using it. And to theorize about that, like we don't have source code for extremely advanced AI, whatever the best AI is going to be around in 30 years or 100 years, we don't have the source code for that. So we can't just like say, oh, well, now that I have the source code, here's what you should do with it. So instead, we need some theoretical framework for asking questions about a highly advanced AI. And there already are some theoretical frameworks like that. There's rational choice theory, which says, well, you know, if you're doing a good job of reasoning, your choices between lotteries won't undo each other. They won't be mutually contradictory in a way that you can get. Have you guys, raise your hand if you heard the phrase like Dutch booked? Yeah, so you're not going to prefer thing. You know, your preferences should be transitive. If A is better than B and B is better than C, A should be better than C. Otherwise, I can engage you in this weird counterfactual trade cycle where you like counterfactually lose a ton of money. And like if A, B, and C are commodities, then you actually factually lose a lot of money. So there's a theory for like how to not screw that up. It's called rational choice theory. And there's a nice theorem called the von Neumann. Who's heard of the von Neumann-Morgenstern theorem? Probably fewer people. Yep. But there's a nice theorem. Check it out on Wikipedia. It tells you how to do that. Good. But this theory presupposes this notion of probability. And it turns out that there's also a pretty reasonable theory of how to do probability good. It's called probability theory. And just, you know, if you just follow these five simple rules, then you'll do probabilities good. You know, your probabilities at least won't contradict each other in a way that you would lose lots of money. But it turns out that, you know, this probability thing is not really doable in practice. You can't actually write an algorithm that just does the Bayesian updating thing. It's impossible because of dimensionality problems, et cetera. So halting problem, nothing else. So this probability, while this rational choice theory makes a function call to this probability theory in order to even talk, right? Like if you look at the V&M theorem, it's got probabilities in it. This probability thing has to make a function call to like some other theory that like actually computes or like does the probabilities in the real world somewhere. And it should roughly obey question mark theory, which is not defined yet. And hopefully there's some question mark asterisk theorem that like tells you how to do the question mark theory good. So that's what we're trying to do here is like complete, you know, this table. And that's what logical uncertainty and logical induction is about. So for the rest of the talk, I'm going to get into the results now. But for the rest of the talk, I just want you to keep this sort of picture in mind. We're not talking about these probabilities that you'd have if you finished thinking. We're talking about what you should think before you're done thinking, before your computation is finished. Cool? All right. So, and now for math. This is another slideshow that fits inside the previous slideshow. It's like a quine. Maybe we'll talk about quines. So this talk is based on our paper. Paper is going to be updated more frequently on intelligence.org than at the archive. And likewise, these slides more frequently than on intelligence.org will be updated at my website because I don't want to bug the webmasters all the time. So now I'm going to start defining stuff. So we're going to let L be some language of propositional logic. So that just means it's got these connectives. Hands up for who knows what propositional logic is? Who knows the difference between propositional and first-order logic? Sweet. Okay, so first-order logic has quantifiers. You're allowed to have quantifiers in here. You can view any first-order theory as an instance of propositional logic where the quantified statements are atoms in the propositional calculus. So if you knew what that meant, good. If you didn't know what that meant, don't worry about it. What matters is that our language has these operations that you can use to combine sentences. Cool? All right. We're going to let S be all the sentences in our language, like piano arithmetic. or ZFC, could also use that. And then gamma is going to be some set of axioms. So that could be, if you want to do piano arithmetic in propositional calculus land, where you've only got these connectives and modus ponens to do deduction, you'd better include the axioms of first order logic that let you, you know, apply the quantifier rules. You guys, not if you know what I'm talking about. Raise your hand if you know about this trick of including the axioms of first order logic in the axioms of piano arithmetic so that it can be propositional. Fewer people. All right, so it gets fewer and fewer. All right, this is just me measuring, like gauging who I'm talking to. So if you knew what that was, good. If you didn't know what it was, don't worry. You might need some extra axioms in your theory to tell you how quantifiers work. Now, a belief state is going to be this very concrete object. A belief state is a list of sentences and probabilities assigned to those sentences. That's it. And I say probabilities. By probability just means a number between 0 and 1, and we'll justify later in what sense it makes sense to think of those things as probabilities. So it's just a map. It's you could have some constant that tells you what the map should evaluate to outside that set. It's natural to use a half, but for our proofs, we use 0. It doesn't matter. It turns out not to matter what probabilities you put outside the thing. And does that make sense? So I'm just saying, you list out some number of probabilities, and I'm going to interpret all of your other sentences that you didn't list as you having said they're probability 0. But if you prefer to think a half, think a half. a reasoning process is just like something that goes along printing out belief states. On day one, we have this like day terminology. On day one, it like prints out a list. All right, here's the sentences I've thought about so far. Here are the probabilities for them. Day two, it prints out a bigger list, maybe. Maybe it updates the probabilities from the previous day and adds some new sentences and probabilities. Does that make sense? So it's just a sequence of like belief states that can be updating. And we want to say that, you know, logical induction is about having a good sequence of belief states. So we have to define good. So here are some properties that you might want for a sequence of belief states. You might want it to actually be computable. So we're just going to assume that off the bat. We're only going to talk about things that you can actually run an algorithm to do. If you can't run an algorithm, I don't want to hear about it. It'd be nice, maybe, if you converged to some answer, like fix some sentence like the Riemann hypothesis or maybe the continuum hypothesis. Think about it for a long time. Maybe you should make up your mind about it. So that's saying that limits should exist. Maybe, you know, all the stuff I've been saying about like, oh, the probability theory rules you can only satisfy after infinite time. Maybe you should demand that you, in fact, do satisfy the laws of probability after taking a limit. And maybe you should not believe stuff that you can't prove. Maybe not everyone agrees with me on that, but I'm just gonna throw that in there as a thing that you might like. If our proof system doesn't prove phi, then maybe you'd like not to assign it probability 1, and if it's not disprovable, maybe you shouldn't assign it probability 0. Okay, so those are the most basic properties that you might ask for. And we have an algorithm that does all those things, which is nice. And moreover, it does all those things.
In the previous slide, is the limit allowed to be 1 even? Oh, sorry, okay. So yeah, the limit can't approach 1 even if any finite step you've ever reached.
The limit can't be 1 unless the thing is provable. So P infinity of 1 plus 1 equals 2 will be 1.
So like P infinity. Checking if pi, if I was looking for a structure in pi and if it required me to look at every digit and it's like a countable property, I could never finish, but I can imagine if I were to check every digit.
So you might be looking for a property like if for all n phi of n, if phi of n is true for every n or is provable for every n, then you want to assign probability 1 to the for all statement. So that's an interesting property. People have asked for that property. You're not the first person in the world. A guy named Geifman wants this property. We're going to see that maybe you actually don't want that property. But among those statements here, this is a fixed statement for one thing. So this phi here is like you fix a sentence and then take the limit as time goes to infinity. And your belief about that sentence should be strictly less than 1 if that sentence was not provable. So like the consistency of piano arithmetic, for example, is not provable in piano arithmetic. but all the finitistic consistency sentences are. Do you guys know this? Like the statement, there is no proof of contradiction in fewer than n characters in piano arithmetic? In piano arithmetic? That statement is provable in piano arithmetic for every particular value of n, but the quantified statement for all n that is the consistency statement of piano arithmetic, which it cannot prove by Gödel's theorem. So what this would say is that you should not assign probability 1 to the for all statement, but you'd better assign probability 1 to all the finitistic versions. That's a great question.
Do we have that requirement though, that it must assign probability 1?
To the for all? No. We do not have that. Yep. We don't have that as a requirement. And I might argue that you should not do that.
Not for the finitistic ones.
For the finitistic ones, yes.
Okay.
Yeah, because they're all individually, so that you can see that that would follow from, we'll see that follow from other stuff later. Yeah.
Falls from coherent limit, too.
Yeah, bundled in here. I didn't like write down the like if you prove something then it's true, but bundled in here is the definition of like provable things should have probability one. So we have an algorithm. It does all those particular things, and the way that it does all five of those things is that there's a single thing that it does. And that thing implies the other five things. So there's this like bottleneck property, kind of like the axioms of group theory. If you like just pass this one like filter, now you're a group and you get to have all these nice things like normal subgroups. There's like this one axiom, and if you just do that, then you get all those other nice properties. And it's called Garibrandt induction criterion. In paper, we call it logical induction criterion because Garibrandt is a co-author. So we can't call it that, but I can call it that. And the paper shows that those are all they're all feasible, and moreover, there's a bunch of other properties that come from this, you know, the same bottleneck property, the Garibrandt induction criterion, which I will now talk about. I could start telling you what the algorithm is, but I claim you should not care that much yet what the algorithm is, because unless it has nice properties, who the hell cares what it does? So let me tell you some properties it has, so that you can try caring about it. We have a stronger property of the non-dogmatism thing I mentioned earlier, which is that actually, if you have a computer program that's outputting sentences that are all mutually consistent, so it's just spitting out a ton of sentences and the conjunction of the time n is always consistent, not disprovable, then there's actually some fixed epsilon such that all the statements in that sequence will be assigned probability at least epsilon at time infinity. So notice here, we'll see later instances where like these subscripts match, but here we're talking about time infinity applied to statement n. There's this other nice one, which I like even more, which relates the probability of an independent sentence, like the continuum hypothesis, to its Kolmogorov complexity in a prefix-free encoding, which is pretty sweet. Basically, the probability at time infinity, once you've finished thinking forever about the continuum hypothesis, you will assign it some probability that's at least a constant times 2 to the minus Kolmogorov complexity of the continuum hypothesis. So it's kind of like Occam's razor. There's also the converse, which is the thing is not provable, then you'll assign a probability of less than 1 minus c times. It's just like the dual of this. So it's not the way I'm going to use this to like call out Occam's razor as like a slightly bad meme, because people say like complicated things are unlikely, but that's not true. Really complicated disjunctions can be very likely, right? Like if I just write like a massive super long disjunction of claims, that's probably true, right? So it's not that complicated things shouldn't be likely. Is it like complicated things can like simple things should be like closer to, you shouldn't have extreme beliefs about simple things is what this says, if they're independent. If they're provable, then yeah. Now we're gonna get on to questions where the like question is getting harder as the inductor thinks longer. So those are all questions where, you know, you give it a question, and then it thinks forever about that question. Now we're going to get to the questions getting harder in synchrony, in tandem, with the logical inductor, we call it. So we're going to say that a sequence of statements, phi, overline mean sequence, is efficiently computable if they can be spit out in polynomial time in n. So the nth one, you run an algorithm that runs in time n, not log n, time n, time polynomial of n, and spits out your sentence. And we only require that the sentence be written down in time polynomial n, not that it be proven in time polynomial in n, not that it be parsable. You know, you don't have to be able to parse it or evaluate any expressions in it in time polynomial n. You just have to write it down in time polynomial in n. So efficiently computable sequences of sentences you should think of as being things that are easy to write down or state, but potentially very hard to verify. And we're always going to be talking about these efficiently computable sequences, or ECs. It's nice that EC kind of sounds like EC. We're going to be talking about those. I don't think we tried that. So when you see EC statements, think easy to state, hard to verify. And here's an example of some sentences that are easy to state but hard to verify deductively. If I say g of n, there's this diagonal lemma that you can use to cook up a statement that refers to its own Gödel encoding. If you know about Gödel numbers, cool. If you don't, just pretend this thing can talk about itself, it's fine. Statement that says, there is no proof of this statement in less than or equal to f of n characters, where f of n is your favorite giant fast-growing function. So pick some Ackermann of n or something like that. Really computable, has to be computable, real big computable function. Notice that, these, to be clear, this underline here means like you write down the expression for g and then you substitute the numeral for n in it using you should use binary encoding for numbers. Don't use successors. You can use successors if you want, but I'll be angry at you. This here, f, means write down the source code of f in the language of piano arithmetic. It's actually writing down some predicate that represents the function. If you know about the representability theorem for computable functions, it's that. Otherwise, just think about this is the source code for f followed by n. Make sense? So this says, you can't prove me in less than or equal to this number of characters. But you can write that statement down in log n time, right? It's like a template. You just sub in n. But if gamma, our theory, is consistent, it's sure as hell not going to prove this in less than or equal to f of n characters. So just stare at that for a minute. All right, I saw some chuckles, so that means some people are getting this thing. Do you guys see, not, give me a, wave your hand if you see why this statement is in fact true, but not provable. All right, let me go through why this thing is not provable in piano arithmetic. In f of n, in less than or equal to f of n characters. Yeah, exactly. So if you proved it in less than or equal to f of n characters, it would be true. I'm calling on your belief that piano arithmetic only proves true things. So because it's true, there's no proof of it in less than or equal to f of n characters. That's a contradiction. If you give it a short proof, it says there's no short proof. So you're wrong. You didn't. Okay? But it can have a long proof. And in fact, because it's a finitistic statement, you can actually prove it by just searching through all strings of that length, at most that. So in fact, if this thing is true, it's provable using a very long proof, but it has no short proof. So this is a demonstration to you guys that there are statements that are very easy to write down, but they're very hard to prove just using logic. Nonetheless, we have this algorithm that believes them anyway, and it believes them real fast by comparison to logic. So for any efficiently computable sequences of statements, our algorithm, which has like a fixed runtime, Scott won't let me say what runtime it has. I think we can make it have runtime less than triply exponential, probably less than double exponential. For theoretical reasons, we made it nicer to do proofs about, which makes its runtime horrible. So don't worry about the runtime. It has a runtime. It's an algorithm. And if you have a sequence of provable statements, eventually on day n, so if you think each day you print out the statement and ask the logical inductor, what's your probability today of this statement? and it assigns probability, eventually starts assigning probability very near one to those statements. The fact that this n here is not infinity is really important. Otherwise, the thing is like not that interesting. So here's how you like visualize what's happening here. On day one, you say, yo, logical inductor, what's your probability of statement number one? And it says, I don't know. I just woke up. I was just born. Okay? Next day, you're like, yo, what's probability? It's day two. What's your probability of the first statement? And it's like, dude, I still don't know. I'm thinking. Okay? And meanwhile, you've also asked it. You can query it. It's not interacting with you, right? It's just printing out a list every day. And you're querying the list that it prints out. Okay? But for fun, you're talking to the list as it comes out because you're a little quirky. So the list comes out and you're like, yo, list, what do you say about V2? And the list looks at you and says, yo, I don't know either. So this goes on for a while, but like eventually, maybe at like P1000, you're like, the list is like, whoa, I just realized that that first thing you said is a theorem. I'm like pretty sure it's true now. Okay? So the theorem is saying that eventually this is going to happen. But, you know, who the heck knows what it's going to say about V2 at this point? Maybe it's like, I still don't know. 51? I don't know. 50%. And then maybe on day like a trillion, it believes the first two. I don't know how many zeros I just wrote. 99.99%. And so it looks like there's this really thin sliver of things that it's believing over time, right? Compared to like the number of questions you're asking it. But what the theorem says is that this thin sliver of answers eventually like catches up with this diagonal. And eventually the theorem has stated, did that thing advance on its own? Or did I? Oh, I must have clicked it while I was excited. What the theorem says is that eventually, on day n, it's believing the nth theorem. And moreover, you can strengthen this thing which to say that, in fact, it continues believing the thing after that. So we actually end up in a situation where eventually, like the things it believes, I guess that blue was stuff it didn't believe. So the stuff that it believes eventually just like catches up, and it's just like, yeah, I believe all the things I've seen so far. And you bring in another one, it's like, yeah, that's probably true too. Questions about that?
I get the analogy, but
yeah. Should you? That's coming. I mean, in the limit, it's only going to assign probability one to true things. But maybe, you know, at a finite time, it could assign probability one to a thing that's false, and then, or probability near one to a thing that's false. But we'll get to more properties that are make it more deserving of trust, I would say.
Also, are we able to choose the ordering of the statements? Like, what if we really care about is V1001, but it's not going to get to that for a long time? Can we put that first in the list? So,
you could.
On the list.
Yeah, I mean, you can, the thing is not interacting with you, it's just printing out a list. So in fact, it doesn't matter what order you ask it the questions, it's going to give the same answer. So you can't, yeah. Now, there's questions of like, how could you modify the algorithm to answer certain questions sooner than others? We haven't done that. Surely you can do that. Yep.
Is there any monotonicity condition on the probability? So could you have something like P1 of P1 is 100%, and then the next day it's down to 50%. So.
There is not a monotonicity condition, but okay. There will be a you can't do that too much condition.
Okay.
Yeah. So you can think about this algorithm, whatever, you know, I said, suppose I have this algorithm that's printing out true statements, right? That's a tricky thing to do. You know, I had to, you know, you have to do some work to make a computer program that actually prints out things that keep being true, keep being provable. So you can think of this program that's like, spitting out these things that are always provable, think of that as being like Ramanujan. Ramanujan is very, it's using some, maybe it's a neural net, I don't know how it works, right? But it's using some intuitive way or some heuristic or some trick for writing down true things. And meanwhile, G.H. Hardy, that That's like our P over here. V is like Ramanujan and P is like Hardy. Hardy like keeps getting these letters from Ramanujan. And like the first, you know, he's already gotten the first five letters and he checks the first one and he finally proves the thing. He's like, okay. And eventually he starts proving more of Ramanujan's claims and starts trusting Ramanujan even though he can't prove everything Ramanujan says anymore. So that's what you should imagine happening here, that like the proofs of these statements that it's believing on day N are just could just be arbitrarily far out of reach for any program to ever find a proof for. But the thing just believes them by a kind of inductive inference property. Which is kind of cool. This illustrates that like inductive inference, like noticing patterns and believing them, can make you believe stuff faster than logic. And I claim they can also make you believe things pretty well, and that will be like the content of some more theorems. So that last theorem is a special case of this one. We've got a definition of pseudo-random in our paper. I'm not going to get into it now, but if you fix some runtime class, there's a notion of like pseudo-random with respect to that runtime class that roughly says that runtime class can't find any patterns in the thing. And you can look at the paper for details, but basically, if you have a pseudo-random sequence of statements that are all provable or disapprovable, and if the limiting frequency of the provability of those things is p, so if they're true roughly p of the time, then the logical inductor eventually learns that frequency and starts assigning it to every sentence as it shows up. So the nth statement comes in and it says, you know, if p is 60%, if 60% of these things are true, eventually on day n it's like, well, I can't tell if this thing is true, but 60%. And it'll be like well calibrated in the sense that this p will match this p. Questions about that?
So actually, r is some unspecified fixed.
Yeah, there's a fixed r. You can look up in the paper what the r is. Yeah, and in fact, if I said now, it'd be a little bit of a spoiler, actually. So, but there's an r. Yep.
What exactly do you mean when you say a sequence is pseudo-random with a frequency?
Well, it means that if you just take the limit as n goes to infinity of the fraction of that sequence that was provable, you get p. The frequency is p. It's like, yeah.
Meaning that something with an algorithm that runs at O of R n would not be able to distinguish between pseudo-random and what? Binomial with the expected value p?
Yeah. Roughly speaking, yeah. So one thing that's true is that if you like used an actual p, like a coin with a bias of p,
yes,
and then wrote down the outputs of that coin, which you're not like in our framework, everything's a computable thing, and a coin is like a random thing. We're not yet taught
distinguishable from this.
Yeah,
and all of our
something. Yeah, right. In and you know we have to define what distinguishable means. We got a notion of distinguishable, but it's indistinguishable from random. Yeah.
And your notion of indistinguishability is distinguished from the standard one.
Yeah, it's a little bit different. Yeah, yeah. But it's good. You should look. It's good. It's a good definition. So, yeah.
It's equivalent for like some class. Like there's some class for which it's like one. Like by changing the class, you make one stronger or weaker than the other.
Okay.
Scott says there's a way of relating the two definitions by changing. I'm for the recording. There's a way of relating them by changing these classes here. We can ask Scott off camera what that's about later. Moreover, there's another version of this that's better where this P is allowed to change over time. So you have some efficiently computable sequence of probabilities. And the thing is like, you know, the frequency is maybe it's high for a while, then it's low for a while, whatever. It learns that too. But I'm not going to write it down. You can look it up. Now, note that that property on its own is actually not that hard to satisfy. Like, if I just gave you this goal, like, you know, exercise, go home, and make an algorithm that has this property, it's actually not that hard to make. The interesting thing is having this property along with all the other ones, especially the one where, in the limit, your probabilities satisfy the laws of probability theory. That was historically very hard for us to get at the same time. So what's interesting here is not that we can do this. I mean, it's somewhat interesting we can do this, but it's more interesting we can do all the things at once. So it's trickier to get that property along with P infinity actually being a coherent probability distribution. Yep.
So your EC sequences, I mean, you said they're sequences that are easy to produce, but the things are short to, or are long to prove. So if you had actually changed that to say, you know, outputting true statements, could this still work? I mean, assuming you sacrifice the non-dogmatism.
Right. So the question is, can you make the thing also believe not only true statements, not only provable statements, but true statements?
Yeah.
And so for true, you're going to have some choice of model or some choice of completion. So maybe you pick the naturals as your favorite. And the answer is that there's two other, if you want that property, there's two other properties you have to give up.
But you can do it if you give
up. I mean, there's a single algorithm that will have that one property, but there's, yeah. And in fact, if you do that, well, as well, yeah. If you do that, you might lose a lot of bets. Or you might be seen as losing a lot of bets by some people, right? People who believe in, okay. Anyway, I had just said that pseudo-random, this like learning pseudo-random frequencies thing was hard to get along with the coherent limit property, the property that your limit is a coherent probability distribution. And in fact, there's this like thing that happens before the limit that you can also get, which is say you have some sentences that are at, for every n, there exists a proof, possibly very long, that these sentences are mutually exclusive and exhaustive, meaning that exactly one of them is true. If there's always a proof, possibly very long, that exactly one of them is true, then eventually Pn catches on to that, and then on day n, it starts assigning probabilities adding up to 1. So this is a case where you'd have the probabilities of the digits of pi adding up to 1. And in fact, there's a stronger version of this where there's a bunch of other coherence relationships that you might want to write down. And in fact, any coherence relation that you can write down that relates these probabilities via an affine function, so linear plus a scalar, if it's true in all consistent worlds, meaning in all consistent truth assignments to sentences with gamma, then in fact it'll be true, sort of, it'll start happening on day n. So I keep saying this happening on day n thing. This has motivated us to actually make a definition. We say that a sequence of probabilities is being, well, first we've got this asymptotic notation, which is pretty standard. These sequences are like asymptotically equivalent if their difference goes to 0, x asymptotically at least y. The difference has infimum 0, so it could always be, it could be like slightly less than y for a long time, but then the infimum has to catch up. And we say that P assigns probability P bar to phi bar if P sub n of phi sub n is asymptotically P sub n. So flipping back a slide, this is saying, if I can remove the limit, right, this is just saying some of these probabilities is asymptotically equivalent to 1 as a function of n. And we have this double subscript n thing going on all the time because it's the induction catching up to the rate at which you're asking questions that makes a lot of our results interesting. So now we're getting into some like Gödel-Escherbach stuff right here. So you can ask this thing, what are your beliefs? It's an algorithm, right? It's an algorithm, so you can write it down, you can encode it in Piano Arithmetic, you can ask it questions about that algorithm that it is. You don't have to tell it this is you, right? You just say, hey, what do you think about this algorithm? And it will have answers eventually. And we can ask, what's the probability that you assign probability between 89 and 91% to that claim over there? And what this says is that, roughly speaking, it knows what it thinks. And it knows what it thinks at the time that it thinks it, not like slightly after. Like on day n, it prints out a giant column of beliefs, and somewhere in that column is its probability for phi sub n. And somewhere else in that same column is its probability for the statement, my probability for phi sub n is in this interval. And, if there's this sequence, delta approaching 0, such that its beliefs are actually within the interval by that little margin of delta, if you give it a little margin of error, a little wiggle room, if its beliefs are like sort of well within this interval by a tiny definition of well, then in fact it will know that its beliefs are within that definition, within that interval, for a tiny definition of the difference between knowing and being 100% sure. So for every delta, there exists an epsilon such that if you're delta within, then you are you're like epsilon sure that you're within.
And can you compute that probability faster?
No.
Okay.
So there's some fixed point like stuff that goes on that's kind of looks like bootstrapping. So there's something like that that's true. And likewise, if you're outside the interval by this like margin of error, then you'll know that you're in, that you're outside the interval. Oh, that should be a not element sign right there. Thanks. And so now that the thing is talking about itself, you might think that you can diagonalize it, right? Like you can say, yo, what about if I write a sentence that says you don't believe this sentence? Anyone ever ask you that? Who's heard of the liar's paradox? This sentence is false, right? It's really annoying. What if they just come up to you and they're like, yo, Ryan, you don't believe this sentence. Everyone else is allowed to believe it except for Ryan, right? Well, maybe. There's this interesting thing, because Ryan is this thing that changes over time. And what actually happens, if you write down a sentence, L sub n, that says that a logical inductor does not believe this sentence with probability more than p, so maybe p is some small, I don't know, maybe say p is 1%. You write down a sentence that says L is not believed with probability more than 1%. What actually happens is that, so first of all, L has to change each day, right? Like you say, you don't believe me with 1% now. You don't believe me with 1% now. That's a different statement. Like you are changing. So these sentences are changing each day, and as is the logical inductor. And what happens over time is that it assigns probability converging to that 1% number, that p, to the sentence. Fact. Now, you might think that's kind of weird.
Trying to maximize it, but while still being in the constraint or something.
So, well, it's what happens is that, so here's p, right? And every day it's assigning a probability very close. Eventually, every day it's assigning a probability very close to p. Let's say p is 1%. But what happens is that 1% of the time, it assigns a probability slightly less than 1%. And 99% of the time, it assigns a probability slightly greater than 1%. So it actually remains calibrated. Like there, these sentences L sub n, in fact, it makes the sentences be true 1% of the time. And then it assigns probabilities very close to 1% to them. Moreover, the way it's like oscillating here is very hard to predict. It's pseudo-random in the sense of the previous thing, in previous definition. So it's going to be real hard to like make it lose bets because you're not going to be able to predict if you're like a low runtime person. You're not going to be able to predict which side of 1% it's going to be on. So roughly what's going on is it's trying not to lose bets, and as a side effect of that, it's not going to be very far from 1%. Questions about that? I think this is awesome. I love this thing. This is like Gödel's theorem, take a hike, you know? Sure, I can have beliefs about myself, whatever. I can deal with liar's paradoxes. Another cool thing that it does is it believes that the underlying theory of arithmetic is consistent, if it's consistent. And if it's not consistent, it believes it's consistent too, because it probably ends up believing everything. But we just talk about cases where the thing is consistent, and it believes that. So for every n, if you say con n is the statement, there is no proof of contradiction in less than n characters. Eventually, on day n, it believes that, even though the proof of that is real long. And in fact, you can cook up an even harder consistency statement, pick a real fast-growing function, f, and say, write down the statement, there is no proof of contradiction in Peano's arithmetic using at most f of n characters. And I think I should probably underline that n because it needs to be encoded. And yeah, it eventually believes those two. Yeah.
Think of it like P equals one for a paradox resistance, sorry.
Yeah.
Isn't that like Gödel's statement then?
Yeah, so if you give it, I think if you give it P equals 1, it's going to give probabilities real close to 1, and it's not going to lose that many bets with you.
Okay. But it can't go above 1.
It's going to make, yeah. So, yeah, I think what will happen is it'll assign. So if I let you make really, really big, if I let you, like, have infinite money, then you'll be able to, like, make big enough bets with the thing to make it lose money on those kinds of bets. But if you have finite money with which to bet, start betting with it, you're not going to be able to do very well. Yeah. So it believes in the consistency of the underlying theory, which is nice because you can use the underlying theory to prove that this thing is trustworthy, right? Like you can, we've used like regular old proofs to show that this thing does a good job, and then it can look back at the proof system and say, yeah, that thing probably does a good job too. So it's got this, and yeah, so it, you know, logic trusts it, it trusts logic, and in fact, there's an even better thing, which is that it trusts itself in a certain sense. And in fact, it knows that its future self is smarter than it. So you can write down statements that roughly look like this. You can say, hey, what's the probability of phi sub n? Again, phi is part of an efficiently computable sequence of sentences. What's the probability of phi sub n? Given that future u, f is like some fast-growing function, right? So p sub f of n is like future version of u. Notice that I've underlined P and F and N separately. That means I have to write down the source code for P and the source code for F and the source code for N. I can't evaluate F of N in a short time if it's a real big function. I can just write down the source code for it and then write the number N next to that. And I can ask, given that future U assigns this thing probability at least PN, what probability would you assign? And it's like, oh, future me is smart, PN, at least. Now, I put this thing here, even though it's not quite right. The actual precise statement of the thing involves some expectations of some things we created called logically uncertain variables, which is like in probability theory, you've got random variables. We've got these things called logically uncertain variables. And we've really got a statement that looks like this. The expectation of the indicator of whether this thing is a theorem times this like soft continuous indicator function of this statement. Is asymptotically at least P sub n times this. And if you divide both sides by this guy and squint, it looks a lot like that. But this is the actual result, and this result is kind of a lie. But it feels like that one. So there's a sense in which it trusts itself. And F could just be, you know, itself as well. And so there's a bunch more properties. I'm going to stop with the properties now. And in fact, I don't have... Clock doesn't show up there. Great. There's a bunch more properties. You can do conditional probabilities a different way. We've got these logically uncertain variables, so we've got a theory of expectation of stuff. There's some calibration properties that I didn't talk about, some more calibration properties. If you know what universal semi-measures are, the probability distribution phi at P infinity dominates any universal semi-measure, which means it gets Bayes score, I guess, at least comparable to that. So you can check out the paper for more stuff and proofs. But now I'm just going to say what the actual property is. Like the linchpin property that implies all those nice properties is this. So a market I haven't defined, but that is basically a sequence of belief states, slightly more general thing where the belief states don't have to have finite support. We noticed that we could prove it slightly more generally, so we did. A market is just any sequence of computable functions that write down beliefs, or that would write down beliefs if you ask them. And such a sequence of beliefs P, you can think of belief states as we've been talking so far, satisfies the Garbrandt induction criterion relative to some process that I haven't defined. If there's no efficiently computable trader, which I haven't defined, that plausibly exploits, which I haven't defined, the market relative to that deductive process. So now I'm going to say what those things mean. So a deductive process is just a computable nested sequence of finite sets of sentences viewed as theorems. So in reality, let's say you've got some theorem prover that's like proving theorems in piano arithmetic by bringing in more and more first order axioms and proving more and more theorems from PA and just printing them out. Okay, and every day it prints out a bigger list. So that's what a deductive process is. It's just like a growing list of things that have been proven so far. This is like a third player in a game. There's this kind of game happening where there's like a market. That's our logical inductor that's putting beliefs on things that are going to be interpreted as prices. There's a deductive process, which is like this other thing that's separate from the market. And there's this thing called a trader. A trader is, roughly speaking, something that places bets against the market. So it could come in and start saying, you know, I think the Riemann hypothesis is true, so I'm going to buy a lot of shares in the Riemann hypothesis. Yeah, we call them shares. May or may not be related to me having come from finance right before this. I think it's an actually good way of understanding what's happening. What a trader does on day N is that it prints out a formula for how it's like an actual current Wall Street trader. Like, the trader doesn't come in the morning and knows like how much Apple stock it wants to buy. It comes in and it's like, I have this formula. I'm just going to use the formula. Okay. So a trader on day N writes down a formula that's going to look at the market history of prices, all the probabilities assigned to all the statements by the belief process up until that time. And it's going to output some list of purchases that it wants to make. Like, I'm going to buy some shares of 1 plus 1 equals 2. That one looks like a winner. I'm going to sell some shares of 1 plus 1 equals 3. That one doesn't look so hot. I don't know. Riemann hypothesis, can't tell. I'm not going to buy that today. Okay? And continuum hypothesis, that one I don't know, but it's really cheap. I think I might just buy it. Okay? So there's this formula that does that. And then the market actually, so the trader prints out its formula, the market prints out its new prices for that day, and then the formula interacts with the market and makes the trade happen. So some sentences get bought and sold, and some money gets like accumulated that way. So I've said what a deductive process is. It's these theorems. A trader is this thing that's making bets with formulas. Now, as a trader makes bets over time, it accrues some holdings of sentences that it's bought shares of. Like, maybe it's bought a lot of the 1 plus 1 equals 2 sentence. It's really hoping that that's going to get proven soon, right? And what we do is we view each day when theorems come in, you can use those theorems to figure out what are the trader's holdings worth. So say you've got a trader who owns, I'll do an example on the next slide, but we're going to say, you can think of like once the trader owns some holdings of like bets or shares of sentences, you can use the list of theorems you have so far to like figure out upper and lower bounds on how much those shares could be worth. So over time, the trader's trading and it's like lower bound is doing something, its upper bound is doing something. And we say that you exploit the market if your lower bound doesn't go too far down, it's like bounded below, but your upper bound goes to infinity. So if you can do this, you exploit the market. You don't have to do this. As long as you plausibly have at least minus $1 billion in net worth and it's still plausible, you can still go to cocktail parties and tell people, you know, I own all these shares. It still looks like they might be worth a lot of money. As long as you can do that, you're a winner. Okay? Yep.
Intuitively, that means that DN doesn't disprove too much of what you bought?
Yep. Yep, that's right. And moreover, if you bought like combinations of hedges that you hope are going to work out, it doesn't prove that those hedges are bad. Yeah. So here's like an example of what it looks like. I'm keeping the criterion up here on top and just like bringing in more stuff in case people want to keep staring at that. So say 1 plus 1 equals 2 is a sentence phi and chi is 2 plus 2 equals 4. We can write down an expression like this, which represents like a holdings of minus $1 in cash, probably because you bought some stuff. And then you've got like one share of the sentence phi and one share of the sentence chi. So this is an expression. It's a linear. If you know what the free vector space over a set is, this is an element of the free vector space over the set S union 1, where the 1 represents a cash basis element, and then these are basis elements corresponding to the sentences phi and chi. Otherwise, just look at this, it's a linear expression and it represents how many shares of, if I put a coefficient here like 2, that would mean I had 2 shares of phi. And if I put like minus 10 here, that means I've got minus $10 in cash. So imagine you're a trader and you've done a bunch of buys and sells, and like what you have left at the end of the day is you've got this -$1 in cash, and you've got this phi, and you've got this chi. Suppose there are no theorems proven yet. Suppose it's day five, and no theorems have been proven because your theorem prover sucks. Well, what's the like worst case scenario for you based on what's been proving so far? Yeah, like these could be worthless, right? This could be zero. This share here, this sentence could have a truth value of zero or false, and this could have a truth value of zero or false. And if the sentence has truth value zero, we could say it has zero value as a share. So this could be, whole thing could be worth -1. Best case scenario for you is that they're both worth $1, right? So you could have $1. So if there are no theorems, there's no like nothing we know relating these things, then we're just going to say, you know, these are the bounds on your net worth. Now suppose instead that on day five there was a proof of phi, but no proof of anything else. There's no simple Boolean operations relating these two statements. So what we're going to have is this, you know, is worth $1. That's -1. So you have at least $0 if phi is provable. And you might still be worth $1 if chi turns out to be provable too. Next case is a little more interesting. If, let's say, hey, D5 has a proof of the conjunction phi and chi. In evaluating a trader's net worth, you're allowed to use Boolean logic or propositional calculus. You're allowed to say, ah, there's a proof of this. Well, therefore, you know, phi has to be 1 and chi has to be 1. So that tells you that the trader's worth has to be exactly $1. But we don't allow you to use anything other than pure propositional calculus or Boolean logic. So if someone comes along and proves that for all x, 1 plus 1 equals 2, x doesn't even appear, right? For all x, 1 plus 1 equals 2, well, if that's all you've got, we don't, in estimating a trader's net worth, we don't allow dropping this quantifier or like manipulating the quantifier in any way. The quantifier makes the sentence into like an atom. And until some sentence with that atom appearing in it gets proven, you're not going to have any constraints on this guy. Does that make sense? So if you prove for all x phi, you can't infer phi. The bounds are still going to be -1 and 1. So that's how like estimating a trader's net worth works. There's a big list of theorems. The theorems have some Boolean operations in them. You do Boolean logic to figure out what the atom's truth values might be. There's various combinations that might be possible, and you use those combinations to figure out the net worth of the trader, give it a lower bound and an upper bound. And so now, time permitting, use whiteboard to elaborate and or field questions. An imperative from past me. Past me predicted that someone would be having it, yeah.
Question on the criterion?
Yeah.
So maybe I'm reading it wrong, but it feels like it's saying that in order for a p-bar to exist, the criterion says that it's not useful to any efficient being.
So this is not an existence claim. This is like a criterion. It's like a club, an exclusive club. And if you meet this criterion, we're going to call you a logical inductor.
Okay.
And if you get into the club, then you'll have a bunch of other nice properties. And moreover, we have another theorem that says there's at least one person in the club.
But it seems like the to get into the club,
yeah,
you need to not be useful to anything efficient.
You need efficient people to not be able to win bets against you.
Bets against you. Okay.
Bets against you, yeah. Okay. That's what this is saying. Efficient algorithms cannot print out formulas that win lots of bets or plausibly win lots of bets against you. That perform well in a certain sense. And by performs well, I mean they accrue stocks that plausibly are worth a lot of money, but like are plausibly not worth minus infinity money over time. Yeah. Other question. Yes?
So your notion of Garrett Bradford inductor is fine relative to a deductive process? Or?
That's right. No, it's totally relative to D. Okay. Yep. In fact, relative to D. But thank you for bringing that up, because you're using the deductive process to estimate using Boolean logic. So the deductive process is allowed to use any kind of logic to generate its theorems. But then once it's generated theorems, you use Boolean logic on that output to estimate the upper and lower bounds on the traders. And whether the trader is performing well is as viewed through the lens of that deductive process that's like estimating that allows you to estimate the upper and lower bounds on the trader's worth. Does that make sense?
Okay, so can this be done universally or not?
So all the theorems that I just said were true for any deductive process whose limit d infinity, so if I take the union of all those sentences, if that d infinity is equal to gamma, then all the theorems I just said are true. Moreover, d infinity doesn't have to equal gamma. It could just be that d infinity propositionally implies all the theorems of gamma. So d infinity could just be the list of all the axioms of PA and first order logic together. And then that's enough to all these earlier statements I was making were about this gamma thing. And so that's the case when the union of these theorems are sufficient to prove by propositional calculus all the implications of gamma. Yeah, thank you for that. Yeah, other questions about this so far? So that's the criterion. Of course, there better be an existence claim to go with the criterion, right? Or else it might be like the zero logic or something. So we've got this criterion. It implies a bunch of nice stuff. The way the criterion works is that basically you're trying not to lose a lot of bets, right? So what we show is for all these properties that I just showed you, like non-dogmatism stuff, provability stuff, we just show you that if you don't do that, you'll lose a lot of bets. And our algorithm doesn't lose a lot of bets, so it does this stuff. So it's this nice, simple, like, linchpin property that, like, gets you everything. Yep.
Your algorithm is the market that sets the prices on all of these different theorems.
Say again?
Your algorithm is the market.
That's right.
Definition that sets the prices.
Yeah. And moreover, it satisfies that property while only ever writing down beliefs for a finite number of sentences. So it's very finitistic. Like, at every time, it just lists out its beliefs for a finite set of sentences. And everything that's not in that set, it says probability zero. So there's a while where the traders can just, like, buy free sentences that the algorithm hasn't mentioned yet. And so it's under a lot of pressure to, like, write down probabilities for those sentences before the traders, like, buy too many of them.
So the trader can buy anything at any point in time.
Yeah. Yeah, traders can buy anything at any point in time. I'm going to repeat some stuff because of the video. So if I sound like I'm repeating you for no reason, that's the reason. Cool. So now let me say how the actual algorithm works. So that's how the criterion works. It says don't plausibly lose a lot of bets against efficient algorithms. The algorithm that manages to write down prices or beliefs that don't lose a lot of bets, we're going to call it logical induction algorithm, or LIA. The way it works is first you write down all the efficiently computable people that you could be losing bets against, that you want to not lose bets against. You write a computable enumeration for them. So you can write down a Turing machine that will eventually print out a source code for every single such trader at least once. This can be done. Now we make this thing called a trading firm. It's an algorithm that, like, hires traders that have been doing well and, like, gives them a budget based on how well they've been doing. So it's very much like a trading firm. And what it does is that on day N, this algorithm called trading firm looks at, it can look at any market that you give it. It's a function, so it can take as input any market, any sequence of belief states, P less or equal to N, interprets those as prices, and then it looks at all the different efficiently computable traders that have been named up to N, and then gives them a budget. In fact, it has been giving them a budget all along, such that they don't go below some threshold in their earnings, and then weights them all according to how late they were named and how big their budget is, and puts all those things together into one big trader I'm going to call a super trader. Okay? So the trading firm looks at the market and puts traders together based on the market into a super trader that will exploit the market if the market is exploitable at all. Okay? So this super trader is not efficiently computable. These things are all relatively easy to compute. The individual traders that you're trying not to lose bets to are relatively easy to compute. But the super trader is not. But nonetheless, the super trader has this property where if any of these little guys exploit you, then the trader, super trader does too. So if you can just defeat the super trader, then you win. Okay? Questions about that so far? You know, we can get into more details. You can ask me after. There's the paper. But I'm giving you a sketch because a sketch is like maybe what you wouldn't get if you just read the paper. So now we have another function called market maker, which looks at any trader or any trading strategy, which is like a formula that a trader writes down on day end to compute its trades for that day. And then it sets prices so that that particular trading strategy is not going to do any well, do any good. So imagine if you're a trader, right, and like the exchange is like reading your source code right in the morning before you like run your algorithm, the exchange could like set the prices so that you can't do very well, right? Maybe. Turns out that if your strategy is a continuous function of market prices, then you can use Brouwer's fixed point theorem to, and someone else can use Brouwer's fixed point theorem to find market prices that you aren't going to trade very much against, and in particular, such that you won't make a lot of money trading against those prices. So there was a Brouwer's fixed point theorem in this talk title, and in fact, that's super key. There's this like key trick where, you know, we've defined these traders to write down formulas that are simple expressions that are continuous, in particular, functions of the market prices. In particular, the number of stocks that you buy of a particular phi, like, has to be a continuous function of market prices as a trader. And it turns out, so that's like a limitation for a trader to satisfy, right? The trader has to use a continuous function. It turns out, well, when you limit traders, that makes the logical induction criterion weaker, it makes the logical inductor dumber, but it's still smart enough. If you are only trying to defend yourself against continuous bettors, you still have to satisfy all these nice properties. So it's enough to say, in order to get all these nice properties, it's enough to insist that you not lose too many bets plausibly against some continuous betting functions. And market maker does exactly that. It looks at continuous functions for betting or for buying stocks and then sets prices so that that strategy won't earn too much money. And both of these actually do so by looking at the deductive process. Or this one does. And our logical induction algorithm, it just fights these against each other. So every day, trading firm looks at the best traders and gives them the best budget. And then market maker simulates the output of trading firm in its head and then writes down some prices such that the output of trading firm couldn't do very well. And you repeat. And that generates, so yeah. So basically what's going on is the way that we demonstrate it's possible to not lose bets to a bunch of efficiently computable guys is that you imagine them and then you put them together and then you defeat that thing and then you stop imagining and you write down what you did in your imagination. So you can do that. And the Brouwer's fixed point thing is like really key. You can think of the role of Brouwer as saying like, hey, you know, in the literature, there were all these sort of nice properties that people wanted to satisfy at once. And the trick that Brouwer does is that it lets you, you know, it's kind of like there's all this peer pressure from other people to like make your beliefs coherent in some way. Like there's people over here that will make fun of you if your beliefs don't converge. And there's people over here that will make fun of you if your beliefs aren't like satisfying approximately the AND rule, and I'll probably A and B, right? There's some people who are gonna make fun of you for that. There's some other people who are gonna make fun of you if you assign too high of a probability to the continuum hypothesis or whatever. And you got all these pressures on you, and what Brouwer does is it lets you balance out all those pressures. And formulating those pressures in a framework where we could apply Brouwer, that could be seen as like one kind of key idea here. So satisfying all the properties in a framework that lets you use Brouwer. And so then the theorem just says, hey, if we define our logical induction algorithm recursively by pitting market maker against trading firm, looking at the previous market prices, you get a sequence of beliefs. And this is a this is a computable algorithm. It has some runtime. It's bad. It's very bad runtime. Don't care. This was an existence proof. And the proof just says, hey, you know, if this thing was exploitable, it'd be exploitable by the super trader thing, which doesn't exploit it. So, pfft, nah. all the work is in now, then proving, you know, setting up that, setting up this market maker and trading firm function, which you can like look up. But this, I'm trying to tell you like a rough story so that when you like read the paper, there's like a story in the back of your head that's like parsing the paper. So yeah, any more questions about that? Cool. And I guess I already mentioned that the way these proofs go, like the proof that your beliefs have to converge, we didn't add that as a condition. We say only one rule: you must not lose too many bets. It turns out the convergence follows from the don't lose too many bets rule, because if your beliefs are flip-flopping up and down all the time, people can like buy and sell against you a lot and make a lot of money. So that's how the proof of that goes. That's roughly what this says. I'm going to go a little faster because time is short. Similarly, this like don't assign high probability to non-provable things or low probability to not disprovable things works the same way. If you do that, if you assign probabilities that are going too close to zero to the continuum hypothesis, there's someone who just keeps buying the continuum hypothesis for cheaper and cheaper and like never spends more than $1. They just keep waiting until it's really cheap and like buy a little bit more shares of the continuum hypothesis. And eventually they own like this massive empire of shares in the continuum hypothesis, right? And now they can go to cocktail parties and be like, yo, did you know how many shares I own in the continuum hypothesis? And that's like impressive to people. Okay, so it's winning. It's like getting all the social status of having all the shares, okay? And it doesn't have to be definitely worth anything. It just has to have lots of shares that aren't definitely worthless. So that's the definition, right? It's, you have to plausibly exploit the market. And in the paper we say exploit because we have to say it so many times, we don't have to say plausibly every time, but that's what's going on. It's cocktail parties. So that's how the proof goes, and you can see rigorous details. You know, we've all had we've just had a lot of eyes on this thing trying to make it right. More eyes would be really good. If you see a subscript error somewhere, please email us. And now I'll just kind of quickly say what I think this all means. So, you know, we did this for a reason. It's super fun. It's like fun making an algorithm, but we had like a kind of research agenda in mind when we did this. So I'll go from Beamer back to PowerPoint. So I would say that the current state of like the theory of logical uncertainty, the theory of like putting probabilities or uncertainty on logical claims, is currently fits into the following table. We had rational choice theory in economics. We had a binomial Morgenstern theorem that says how not to make choices between lotteries that would lose a lot of money. We have a simple set of axioms, like four axioms that say if you just satisfy these four rules, then you'll satisfy the binomial Morgenstern theorem. And moreover, if you don't satisfy those axioms, you'll lose a lot of bets. And then there's some algorithms or like, you know, pseudo algorithms that satisfy this thing. So raise your hand again if you were the people familiar with the von Neumann-Morgenstern theorem. Yeah, so some people, there's theorems that say if you satisfy these three simple rules, then you like, don't, I think it's four, then you don't lose too many bets. This theory makes a call to probability theory. So we've got this notion in the same way that you had like a utility maximizer in economics, you've got this Bayesian updater, which is like a subroutine of the utility maximizer, and some basic axioms that say if you do those, you'll like do good and you won't lose too many bets. And moreover, if you don't do those axioms, you'll lose a lot of bets. And then there's these like procedures like Solomonoff induction that sort of, what's the original name of Solomonoff?
Solomonoff's theory for inductive inference.
Solomonoff's theory for inductive inference part 1 and 2 or something. Anyway, there's some things that illustrate a procedure for doing that. And now I would say that we have like some recent progress, which says we've got some theory of logical uncertainty coming out. We got this agent concept that's like error Brandt inductor, which you could think of as a subroutine that a Bayesian updater might should call. Or an instance, you know, you'd probably do better if we think longer and harder about it, because infinity. We've also got this argument that says, yo, if you don't do the criterion of that, you'll lose a lot of bets. So it's kind of compelling. We got all these historical properties that people wanted that are thing satisfies. So that's like sort of an argument that it's like a good agent concept. We've got an algorithm that actually does the thing, so we know it's possible. We do not have a simple set of axioms that say, actually, if you just do these like four simple tricks, you'll turn out to like win. You know, if you can just win against these four simple types of bets, then you'll happen to win against all the other bets. So we don't have anything like a generating set of bet types or trader types that like are enough. So that'd be nice if anyone wants like open problems, groping around for that set of axioms. If you're the groping type, mathematically speaking, you can work on that one. And from this, like extra row on the table, we can already see some cool stuff. We can see that Using Brouwer's fixed point theorem, you can satisfy a fairly arbitrary set of inexploitability conditions as long as they're stated as continuous functions, and which it turns out a lot of inexploitability conditions can. You can trust yourself at the time that you have the beliefs that you want to trust yourself about without having paradoxes, using this like pseudo-random oscillation around 1% thing. That's kind of cool. Self-trust in logic was like always kind of a contentious thing. And you can use inductive reasoning to go a lot faster than theorem provers. You know, this somehow, if you've got some simple procedure that's writing out statements that are true, using inductive inference, you could say, you can learn to trust those statements eventually, reliably, much faster than the proofs are being found. On, you know, for any computable function, you can be that computable function faster than a theorem prover using this thing. So that's kind of cool. Means something about induction versus deduction. All those people who were telling you, like, don't be so logical, maybe they're right. Also, but you have to listen to logic to inductively learn anyway. It's also interesting that we've got some calibration properties that so far it looks like in order to insist that an agent be calibrated all the time, forever, like become and stay calibrated, you need to like be settling its bets fairly quickly. If you're not settling the bets quickly, it actually doesn't have to be calibrated in order to not plausibly lose a lot of money. So you can check out the paper for that. But on sequences that are getting settled, you have to be well calibrated. And on the pseudo-random sequence earlier, you have to be calibrated no matter what. So there's interesting stuff going on with calibration. There's also the fact that we didn't have to add a special rule that says, yo, make sure your probabilities satisfy these coherence laws, like probability of A and B being at most probability of A. It just learns that by losing bets with people who knew that, which is kind of cool. So then what to do from here? I guess, like I said, there's these minimalistic conditions you can look for. You can also ask, do the probability distributions P infinity that you get from different logical inductors, do they have to dominate each other in some way? Do they differ by some multiplicative constant that means that in some sense for P-N arithmetic there's like a canonical probability distribution class that you should have, or are they not comparable? So that'd be a cool thing to know. If anyone wants to figure that out, that'd be great. You can tell us, write papers about it. But we're not going to work on that so much because we're trying to get back to this AI thing and use these Garabrant inductors to now pose questions about reasoners that are actually computable, that, you know, have probabilities assigned to statements before they're proven. Because we want to think about AIs that might think about other AIs, right? We might want to think about AIs that think about their own source code. And that's a math question sometimes. Like, what does this source code do? That's a math question. So unless it's run its own source code already, then it needs to have some probabilities about that, et cetera, et cetera. We hope that AIs have good reasoning about, like, if we're going to make an AI that, like, does good stuff for us, and it might, like, update its, it might, like, you know, do a GitHub update to itself, we hope that it, like, does good GitHub updates to itself and not bad GitHub updates to itself, especially if it's doing a lot of stuff for you. So we want a theory of like doing a good job of that, and at least now we can like write down theoretical models of what it means to do it, like a definition of doing a good job that we know is in principle satisfiable. It's not like this algorithm is, no one's gonna use that algorithm, but it shows that we have a definition of good job that's not impossible to satisfy. And likewise, there's, you know, we're gonna be thinking about other stuff, about AI alignment like we always do, but that's our main mission, is just like prove theorems that'll help us think theoretically about super awesome AI before we have the super awesome AI. Cool. So, you know, there's lots of questions that you could use these things to ask in game theory. Like, you can imagine any situation in game theory where you've got some world state and some agent interacting with the world state, and it's got some objective function that it's trying to optimize. Previously, like all the economics literature usually assumes these like logically omniscient homo-economicus things that just like instantly know the implications of your strategy, right? It's like the Nash equilibrium definition is like, if there exists a thing, blah, blah, blah. So we can now like swap out those agents for logically uncertain agents. And I think people could come up with even better definitions than ours that instead of just being asymptotically good, that are like boundedly good. You know, I see this as like a step in a direction of like having a good definition of logical uncertainty. I think there's more work that could be done. But I think turning these big questions about intelligence, about reasoning, into, you know, turn the crank in your head until they look like math, until that you can now ask the question mathematically. Then maybe you can answer some mathematical version of this, like, fuzzy question, like, can an agent trust itself? Can you inductively learn to, like, believe mathematical? Can you, is there a reasonable sense in which you can believe the twin prime conjecture in a justified way before the proof has been found? Is there any notion of reasonableness there? And I think turning those questions into math is, like, real important, especially as it lets us think about AI in the future. And personally, I didn't think this was going to work. I was like, guys, like, yeah, I know y'all want to, like, make this theory to, like, help us think about AI before we have it. But, like, there's this logical uncertainty thing that people have been, like, thinking about for decades that no one has even managed to define what it means to do a good job of, like, reasoning about logic inductively. So we should just quit and just do machine learning. And in fact, we should do machine learning, but we shouldn't just quit. Because it turns out that if Scott Garbrandt thinks really hard for, like, 2 years, he, like, writes down this thing that's really compelling and has a bunch of properties, and then we all, like, crowd around and, like, prove a bunch of properties about it. So I think I would like to actually, now I've updated to think that I would like to see more theoretically minded people just turning more of these big questions into math questions and trying to crank them out, including some things that might be out of reach, like, what is a counterfactual? Like, what does it mean? What if I, like, changed pi to be 4? What would you do? You know, what if you woke up tomorrow and 5 was 6? Would you freak out? Or would you just, like, buy lots of 5? You know? It's, like, a weird question. That seems, like, absurd. But what isn't absurd is that if you're an algorithm and you're thinking, yo, what should I output today? Should I output 6 or 7? Right? Well, guess what? You're going to output at most 6 or 7. Like, you're only going to output one of those things. And for the moment, when you, like, it's, suppose it turns out that later you're going to output 6, right? Well, while you're thinking about outputting 7, you're kind of thinking, what if this number that I'm going to output wasn't 6? That's weird. If that doesn't feel weird, try to feel weird about it, because it's weird. And, like, there's some sense in which what if pi was 4 is kind of a weird question, but, like, what if I did something other than what I'm going to do is not weird. And there's got to be a way of, like, thinking sanely, for an algorithm to think sanely about what if it does something other than what it's going to do. And, of course, we know this is possible because we do it. It seems pretty sane. But we haven't defined what it means to do that sanely. And you might think, oh, that's too fuzzy of a problem. But, like, no, I claim that if you think really hard, maybe you can, like, write down a definition of doing a good job of that and prove some theorems about it. And I hope people will do that. So anyway, thanks to Scott for having this idea. It's super cool. It's, like, my favorite thing. Thanks to Svi and Nate and Jessica for working with me and Scott on this to, like, make the paper happen. It was really, I tried to, like, figure out how to attribute different theorems in the paper to different people. And, like, the genetic history of every theorem was just so cloudy that we're all, like, it was a really collaborative effort. It was definitely the most collaborative math thing I've ever done. You can't isolate where the things came from. And thanks also to Jimmy, who's not here, but hopefully we'll watch this on the internet, for, like, getting me out of a lot of binds with LaTeX and all of us when shit breaks on the internet. So that's it. Thank you.